Welcome to Behold the Real Jesus broadcast, brought to you by the Jesus Christ International Church, 325 South High Street, Longview, Texas, zip code 75601. We do count it an honor and a privilege to come into your homes and businesses with the Behold the Real Jesus broadcast. We're going to be talking about the man-child. That is, not though the outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Growing up into him in all things, for the Holy Ghost will lead the body of Christ before the coming of the Lord into all truth. Not some of the truth, but all truth. There's not just one scripture that stands alone in the gospel of Jesus Christ for salvation. Therefore, it is a process, not an act in salvation, but a process where we are saved and we're being saved if we continue in faith. If we walk in the light as he's in the light, then we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. It requires obedience. Obedience to the word of God, for he that loveth God keepeth his commandments. Commandments are not grievous. Take my yoke and learn of me, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. But the way of a transgressor is hard. The work of God in the last days is a strange work. When he brings to pass his act, his strange act, for the Lord will lay judgment to the lion and righteousness to the plummet. Why? Because when judgment's in the earth, men will learn righteousness that he came from, God went back to, God proceeded from the Father, went back to the Father. That is righteousness, because I go to my Father. He came from God, became a man. God himself made himself of no reputation to take upon himself the form of a servant to redeem mankind back to himself. The Lord Jehovah God Almighty, the Lord is that Spirit. Jesus is the Lord. And any man that confesses with the mouth the Lord Jesus, that he's the Lord Jehovah God Almighty, and believes in thine heart, not in the mind, not an intellectual knowledge of Jesus, but in thine heart, that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That heart is a heart belief, not in an intellectual belief. Believing in the heart requires a circumcision of the heart. That he is a Jew, that is one inwardly, in the circumcision of the heart and the spirit, whose praise is not of man but of God. How do we get the believing in the heart? The heart has to be circumcised, that the body, the sins of the flesh, might be destroyed. And that is simply by baptism. Romans 6, 1 through 4, what know you not, as many as were baptized into Christ's death. In Romans 6, 4, why? That the body, the sins of the flesh might be destroyed. Colossians 2, 10, you're complete in him and have need of nothing else, in whom you're circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. What is circumcised? Your heart, your spirit is circumcised. It's a circumcision in the spirit. How? By baptism. Colossians 2, 12, that the body of the sins of the flesh might be destroyed in the putting off of the sins. That is cutting, circumcising, destroying the remission of your sins by baptism. Through faith in the operation of God who's raised him from the dead, that circumcision of Christ. Assuming that we go into the feast of the Lord and we must eat the flesh and drink the blood of Jesus, and by so doing, we are entering and not being just saved, but being saved. through obedience. The Feast of Weeks, Feast of Passover, Feast of Tabernacles are the three seasons of God. And in the three seasons of God, we have seven feasts. The Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of First Fruits, which are natural feasts of the Lord, not the feast of the church, not the feast of Israel, but feast of the Lord. This is how we eat his flesh and drink Jesus' blood, John 6. And then we come to the fourth feast, which is Pentecost, where you numbered 7 weeks, and on the morrow, which was 50, or Pentecost, and 50 days, and then the Feast of Trumpets, which is the Rosh Hashanah, bringing us to Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and then ending in the Feast of All Feasts, or the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Ingathering, the Feast of Sevens, the Feast of Prophecy, the Feast of All Feasts, gathered to the Lord. Seven feasts, three seasons, and where we are, as we have partaken of the feast of the Lord, we've eaten Jesus' flesh and drank his blood, but we must come unto perfection, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, unto a perfect man. And that means Christ our Passover sacrifice for us, then he was buried, unleavened bread, no sin in him, 3 days in the heart of the earth, and after 3 days, first fruits, he was resurrected from the dead, the first begotten from the dead. Then this was water baptism, because how do we get into the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus? Well, simply Passover, that is in the outer court, the altar burnt offering, we repent. Then we go to the labor with a foot, baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. We're raised in the newness of life. Then we come into the church age, or what we call the sanctuary, and under the law, which was our schoolmaster in Christ, south side of that we had the 7 golden candlesticks, the north side, the table of showbread with 2 rows, 6 in each row, the golden censer, or the ark of incense, right there before the veil, there, which is our dedication, consecration, fasting, prayer, and that is the realm of dedication. And we come into the Holy of Holies, or that is the most holy place, which is the promised possession. And there we have the Ark of the Covenant, or the testimony. And three different seasons here. Passover spoke of this outer season there. We come up out of Egypt, out of the world. We come into the church age. We've been here for over 2,000 years, and that is second day. And now we're going into the third day, and when in the third day he will raise us up and we will live in his sight. The question is, how do we get there? What kind of work is a strange work when God brings to pass his act, his strange act? In Isaiah 28, he said he'll lay judgment to the lion and righteousness to the plummet. For that is the length, width, height, and depth of Jesus Christ. It's all in him. All the feasts of the Lord are fulfilled in Christ Jesus. Now we will experience it through his finished work of Calvary, Golgotha. Our sins rolled away, the salvation plan completed, and the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And how do we get into it? They asked Peter on the day of Pentecost, which had the keys to the kingdom, men and brethren, what must we do? Acts 2:37. Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. That's the heart of the individual, the literal spirit of man, the circumcision of the heart in the spirit, and the body of the sins of the flesh, all the sins that have been in that person's life, all that lifetime are cut off, and we have a regenerated heart. And that is a new creature in Christ Jesus. This is born of the water. So in water baptism, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Baptism says that is a work. No, it's not a work, it's faith. Through baptism, by baptism, through the operation of God, the circumcision of Christ, that the body of the sins of the flesh might be cut off by baptism, Colossians 2:12, through faith in the operation of God, requires faith. By that repentance and baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, then we're raised in the newness of life that is born of the water. But then, that is still not born again, because you must be born of the water and the Spirit, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That is Spirit baptized. We call that with baptism of the Holy Ghost, and that with fire. Well, that's four feasts. Repent, baptize in the name of Jesus Christ, and receive the Holy Ghost. You have partaken of four feasts of the Lord. Somebody said, I was baptized, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. You never were baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, which name is Jesus Christ. So I exhort you, if you've only been baptized in the name of Father, Son, Holy Ghost, according to the Word of God, be baptized in the name of the Father, which is Jesus, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, which name is Jesus. Jesus is coming, he said, I'm coming in my Father's name, John 17. Father, I've kept through thine own name those that thou hast given me. I've manifested thy name, your name, not mine, your name. John 5, I'm coming in my Father's name. Jesus coming into Jerusalem said, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. The Lord Jehovah God Almighty's name is Jesus. The revealed name of God is Jesus. He is Jehovah, manifest in a body of flesh and blood. Jesus, my God, has become my salvation. Well, taking on the name, go ye into all the world, teaching and observe all things whatsoever commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. That name is Jesus Christ. So Peter, having the keys of the kingdom, realizing the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost is Jesus, on the day of Pentecost, to get into the church age, the promise of the Father, which saith he, you've heard of me, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. The body of the sins of the flesh cut off. That is the circumcision of the heart, where you can believe in the heart, not with the intellectual mind, but believe with thine heart, according to Romans 10:9. And that is by baptism. Somebody said, baptism doesn't save you. Oh, yes, it does. 1 Peter 3, in the days of the long-suffering of God, in the days of Noah, when eight souls were saved by water, the like figure which baptism doth also now save us. Not the putting away the filth of the flesh, but an answer of a good conscience toward God. Where's the conscience? It's in the heart of man, in the spirit. And how's that conscience purged from dead works to serve the living God? By baptism, born of the water. Then you go on and be born of the Spirit of God. When you receive the Holy Ghost, you are born of the Spirit. You must be born of the water and the Spirit. Now you're born again. Is that all of the feast of the Lord? No, you've partaken of four. If you have been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, which is the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, for the remission of your sins, the heart circumcised, where you believe with the heart, you're born of the water, and then born of the Spirit of God, receiving the Holy Ghost. For that literally is exactly the gospel of Jesus Christ, as was proclaimed by Peter on the day of Pentecost, literally spoken in the beginning of the church age, in the filling and dwelling of the Holy Spirit, of the Holy Ghost, in the body of Christ. When they were filled with the Holy Ghost, they began to speak with other tongues, as cloven tongues of fire appeared and sat on each one of them. Jesus had already died, been buried, and rose again. 50 days later was Pentecost. They received this Pentecostal experience. How did we get into it? Peter said to them in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, born of the water and of the Spirit. Now, we've been there for over 2,000 years since Pentecost. Now, what lies in store for the church in the next three feasts that we must eat the flesh of Jesus and drink his blood in obedience to the word of God? For the Holy Ghost is given to them that obey him, as the Holy Ghost leads us and guides us into all truth. The next feast of the Lord that is next for the church of the living God, as we have already partaken of Pentecost, there remains the Feast of Trumpets. That is the ministry voice of Jesus before the second coming of the Lord and his second advent, when he ascends from heaven with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ rising first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with our Lord. Wherefore, comfort you one another with these words. That ministry voice of Jesus is what we call the work of the ministry. The only ministry there is the Jesus ministry. There is no other ministry but him. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. You see, he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the work of the ministry, for the perfecting of the saints, until we all come into the unity of the faith, not 1,500 different denominations and beliefs and isms and schisms and catechisms and different doctrines of dogmas, but one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one God who's above all, through all, and in us all, the Father of glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, God himself. Many offices and functions of the one Spirit of God, but Jesus is that Spirit. 2 Corinthians 3:17, the Lord is that Spirit. The Lord Jesus is the Father of glory. The Lord Jesus is the Word of God. Revelation 19:13, John 1:14, the Word was made flesh. Revelation 19:13, on his vesture dipped in blood. His name is called the Word of God, King of kings and Lord of lords, who is faithful and true. He is the Holy Ghost. He said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. On the day of Pentecost, he said, it's the promise of the Father, which saith he, you've heard of me. Galatians 4:6 said, God sent forth the Spirit of his Son, which is the same Spirit of the Father, whereby into our hearts, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. For the Spirit of the Father is the Spirit of the Son, one in the self, same Spirit. That is just what Jesus said in John 10:30, I and my Father are one. One in the self, same Spirit. Galatians 4:6 is the same Spirit of the Son as the Spirit of the Father. The Spirit is the Holy Ghost. That is Jesus. Jesus come in the flesh. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Anybody that confesses that Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God, the Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost, is come in the flesh. 1 John 4:1-3 is of God. Any spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, the Word, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God is come in the flesh, is not of God, and is that spirit of Antichrist, which is already in the world. Right here we have the next feast of the Lord, the next season, tabernacles, of where we will have the ministry voice of Jesus there in the body of Christ, and this judgment to the lion, righteousness to the plummet. When the Lord arises to do his work, his strange work, and brings to pass his act, his strange act. This will be in the season of trumpets, of the ministry voice of Jesus, not in a natural feast as of the Feast of Israel, but the feast of the Lord in the last days, where the ministry voice of Jesus will go into all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end will come, bringing us to the Day of Atonement. Everything that Jesus paid for on the cross, we as a body of Christ will receive. And the nations, all the kingdoms of this world, will become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will tabernacle with us and we with him. As we are kings and priests, we will go into the millennial and reign with Jesus Christ for 1,000 years before before the white throne judgment. The next season, Tabernacles, will have the fifth feast of the Lord, which we are now entering into. How will we be counted worthy of that? If you see in Revelation 12, Jesus said, I will so show wonders in the heavens, signs in the heavens, blood, fire, and pillars of smoke. I will show signs in the heavens and in the earth. But we see a sign there in heaven. Revelation 12, verse 1, I saw a great wonder in heaven. There appeared a great wonder in heaven. What was it? A woman clothed with the sun, the moon, and under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Well, we see the sun. The woman's clothed with the sun. That sun is the sun of righteousness. It is the Lord Jesus Christ in his glory, which is a righteousness that is Jesus came from the Father, went back to the Father, which is righteousness. In John 16, he said the Holy Ghost will come in the world and reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me, of righteousness because I go to my Father, and of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. And in John 16, he said, I'm not going to speak in Proverbs anymore. I have yet in the days of his flesh, he said, you will pray, ask the Father in my name and ask that your joy may be full. Hitherto you've asked nothing in my name. But he said, at that day, in a future day, Jesus was talking in the days of his flesh, there's a time coming that you will no more ask the Father in my name, for you will ask me. And I say not that I'll pray the Father for you. Why? Because when Jesus was glorified, he was glorified with God's own self, John 17, 5. You see, Jesus had put off his glory when he made himself of no reputation, Philippians 2, 6. Philippians 2, verse 6, Jesus made himself of no reputation, being in the form of God, made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant made in the likeness of men. He's in the form of God, which is invisible. God is invisible. He is invisible God, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent God, and took upon him the form of a servant. Why? Because the form of a servant made in the likeness of men was the image. In the days of Jesus' flesh, he is the image of the invisible God. He is the express image of his singular person. He is the brightness of his glory. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The words that I speak are not mine. The Father that dwells, houses permanently in me, the manifest God. God manifest in the flesh. The Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost, the God of glory, manifest in the flesh, justified in the Spirit, believed on the world, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, received up into glory. That is Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, manifest in a body of flesh and blood, 1 Timothy 3:16. Now the Lord is going to reveal himself in and through the body of Christ. Jesus said, while I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. But it's expedient that I go away. For if I don't go away, the Holy Ghost, the Comforter, will not come. Why? Because Jesus is that Spirit. He said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living waters. This he spake of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given. Why? Because Jesus was not yet glorified. When he's glorified, the man Christ Jesus, he made himself of no reputation, God being in the form of God, made himself of no reputation to be a man for our redemption. A man lost it. By one man's disobedience, sin came to the world, and death by sin. Therefore, by one man shall my servant make many righteous. God looked for a man, he could find none. He was amazed he could not find a man. All were conceived in sin, shapen in iniquity. But Jesus was not conceived in sin, neither was he shapen in iniquity. In the virgin birth, it was that holy thing for the Holy Ghost, the Most High overshadowed Mary, And the holy thing that was born of her is called the Son of God. The Son of God is the Father revealed. The Word, the Holy Ghost, God Himself, Jehovah revealed in a body of flesh and blood. Not Jehovah Jr., not God Jr., but God Himself, Emmanuel, God with us. And in the days of His flesh, He became the Passover Lamb. He was buried, and He rose from the dead. Passover, unleavened bread and first fruits. How do we get into it? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. In the name of Jesus Christ, you have partaken of the first feast, ate in Jesus' flesh in Passover. And then you were buried with Him, what? In baptism, Romans 6, Colossians 2, verse 10 through 12. Buried with Jesus in baptism, that the body of the sins of the flesh might be destroyed. The circumcision of the heart, that the sins are cut off. And then you're raised in the newness of life. If you have repented, been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, raised as a new creature, the body of the sins of the flesh cut off, you're a new creature because your heart has been regenerated, your spirit has been regenerated, the conscience, they're purged from dead works to serve the living God, you're born of the water, you are partaken of the first three feasts of the Lord. Then you go on and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, Acts 2:38. Well, that's Holy Ghost, baptism of the Holy Ghost, baptism in the Spirit of God, and that with fire. Now you're born of the water and the Spirit. You are partaken of four feasts. Now we're coming into the fifth feast of the Lord, and that fifth feast of the Lord is the work of God in judgment. Isaiah 28 said, the overflowing scourge has surprised the hypocrite. Why the hypocrite? Because the hypocrite is an actor that just goes to church but really does not serve God in all sincerity. He has obeyed. The true believer has obeyed God. You see, whosoever we yield our members as servants to obey, even when we have the Holy Ghost, we must yield our members of our flesh unto Jesus, the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, and crucifying the flesh with the affections and the lust. If we obey God and walk according to the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You see, we can't do our own will. There's a lie out there saying that any old way will go, God will bless your will, and whatever you want to do, He'll bless you in all your deeds, only if you do the will of God. Being not a forgetful hearer of the word, but a doer of the word, shall be blessed in all his deeds. Why? Not doing your own will, but the will of God. Any man does his own will die. Any man does the will of God, he will live. Therefore, Jesus said, if any man come after me, let him deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me. Why do you deny self? Because you deny your own self-will, because you're bought with a price. So now you work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it's God that worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. We must find the will of God and do it. And that we obey the word of God. He that loveth God keepeth His commandments. As we yield our members as instruments of obedience unto righteousness. Obedience required, yes, the Holy Ghost is given to them that obey Him. So we can't live any way we want to live and expect God to bless us and we keep our salvation. You see, not all that say unto me, Lord, Lord, Jehovah God Almighty, Matthew 7, will be able to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Only he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Well done. What did we do? We did the will of God. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. As we go into this ministry voice, what is the ministry voice? Well, it's the ministry voice of Jesus. It's the work of the ministry. For this gospel of the kingdom will be preached into all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end will come. Somebody said, well, that will be over the TV set or over the radio. No, it won't. or it'll be in virtual reality through the computer or by preaching in conferences over some headset you put on and talk to someone overseas. No, it won't. You see, God, no man professes himself to be wise, we'll become fools, because this gospel of the kingdom will be preached into all the world for witness in all nations, and it will be done by not just the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, but the body of Christ themselves. Yes, you. If you're in the body of Christ, God will use you as a ministry voice throughout the world in the last days. And this gospel, in the work of the ministry, will literally touch the whole world as the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached into all the world. And either the nations will receive it or they will not hear and not obey and be destroyed. For all the wicked will be ashes and under the righteous feet in that day, in the day that burneth as an oven, the day of the Lord God, when he will rise, the sun will arise with healing in his wings, and you, the church of the living God, will grow up as calves of the stall, and the wicked will be ashes and under the righteous feet. That before that day, there is a literal voice here of 3.5 years that I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, which are 42 months, which is 3.5 years, or a time, times, and dividing of a time. Somebody said those two witnesses are just Moses and Elijah. No. In that time, times and a half, 3.5 years, and 42 months, in Revelation 12, verse 1, there's a sign. A great wonder appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun. The woman is the church. It is not Mary birthing Jesus, because that had already happened. And these are things that will come to pass here after Revelation 4:1. It is not the rapture of the church. It is the church coming up into a higher glory before the second coming of the Lord. That woman is clothed with the sun. That's the Son of Righteousness, Jesus Christ. The moon and under her feet. The moon is the feast of the Lord. These are moons. The first month, first moon, first lunation, we have Passover and unleavened bread and first fruits. And the seventh moon, seventh month, Ethneim or Tishri, we have the Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Sukkot. Trumpets, Day of Atonement, and Tabernacles. These three feasts are still remaining for us, the body of Christ, to enter into by faith, by receiving those things that must shortly come upon the face of the earth, to try the earth. See, the revelation of Jesus Christ, as God gave unto him, to show unto his servants, and I give power unto my two servants, my witnesses. And those things, the showing his servants, things which must shortly come to pass. What are the things? Faith is the substance of things. Not the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. For the things are seen are temporal. The things which are not seen are eternal. And this is where we are. We are right now at the body of Christ, coming into the fifth feast of the Lord in one of the greatest moves of God on this side of eternity before the Lord Jesus Christ comes the second time without sin unto salvation upon the Mount of Olives. What is it? It's a work there of judgment. It's a work there that power. It's a work of the kingdom. It's a work of the Holy Ghost in and through the body of Christ called the ministry voice of Jesus, the work of the ministry. That ministry is Jesus' ministry. He will confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. That 1 week is a heptad, or a week of years, 7 years. Jesus is given for a covenant to the people. And he will confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. But Jesus is cut off, and in the midst of the week, He will cause a sacrifice and oblation to cease. Well, Jesus did cause a sacrifice and oblation of that law to cease in the midst of the week. That is, Jesus started his ministry at age 30, 3.5 years later. In Passover, he was crucified. Just as on the preparation, the Paschal lamb was killed in there as they ate the Passover, so at the very same time of the 14th day of that first month, Jesus was hung on a cross there, cut off in the midst of the week, but not for himself, and making an end of the sacrifice and oblation. But the war still rages on. There remaineth another 3.5 years of the Jesus ministry. It's already been paid for by the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. The coming of the Lord and the kings of this world becoming the kings of our Lord and his Christ have already been paid for on the cross. Jesus paid for it all. It's all finished, even though we, the body of Christ, have not experienced it yet. It's already paid for. Our salvation is paid for. Our redemption, our sanctification, and our glorification is already paid for by the blood, the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Right here, it's an overflowing scourge has surprised the hypocrite. Why? Because when judgment's in the world, men will learn righteousness. For all will know him then, from the least to the greatest. For the knowledge of the glory of the Lord shall cover the earth as the waters cover the seas. But before them, there's a gospel that will be preached into all the world. Not through television, not through radio, but by the bride of Christ, the body of Christ itself will literally have that power in the last days. In the ministry of Jesus, in the work of the ministry that God has been preparing that church for over 2,000 years, giving some apostles, some prophets, and some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the work of the ministry, for the body of Christ to come to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, for whom he did foreknow, them he did predestinate, the body of Christ, to be conformed to the image of his Son. And those that he predestinated, them he also called. Them that he called, he also justified. And them that he justified, he also glorified, to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. For the Lord Jesus is that Spirit. He is the Holy Ghost. He is the Father of glory. 2 Corinthians 3:17. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. That's the law and the liberty of life. Stand there and therefore in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord are changed into the very same image. From glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. What lies ahead for us is the greatest glory in and through the body of Christ that will be greater than the former reign in the book of Acts. When God calls to come down in the last great reign of his strength. You see, Jesus came, he said in Matthew 16, some of you shall not taste of death until you see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Well, Judas Iscariot obviously was not there because he had hung himself. But most of them were still alive on the day of Pentecost where Jesus came and his kingdom manifest in the spiritual kingdom in the earth. Christ in you, the hope of glory, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost doesn't come with observation where they say lo here or lo there, but is within you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus came, sent forth his Spirit, which the Spirit of the Son is the Spirit of the Father. Galatians 4:6, it's the promise of the Father, which is the Son, Jesus Christ, is come in the flesh. And that flesh, now we're in Christ's stead, saying, be ye reconciled unto God, God given us, the body of Christ, the ministry of reconciliation. The work here is a work in the ministry voice of Jesus going into all the world as a witness unto all nations. What brings it to pass? In Matthew 24, Jesus said there's going to be kingdom against kingdom, nation against nation. Oh, there will be wars, rumors of wars, and famine, pestilences, plagues, earthquakes in diverse places. We've had more earthquakes in the last decade than all 6,000 years combined since Adam was formed and created in the image of God. This is the time, and he said, all these are the beginning of sorrows. Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 10, and Luke 21 talks about a time of sorrows. Those sorrows are birth pangs, travail. Why? Well, as everything goes good and everyone is blessed and we have cars, lands, houses, food, shelter, everything goes on as it was. But whenever tribulation and persecution arises for the word's sake, many sometimes are offended and bring forth no fruits unto perfection. But during that time, tribulation does work patience. Patience does work experience, and experience worketh hope. Hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our heart. How? By the Holy Ghost. Thinking how strange the fiery trial, which is to try you, some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice in as much as you're partakers of Christ's sufferings. Why? That the glory of God resteth upon your head. Paul put it this way, we're troubled on every side, but not in distress, perplexed, but we're not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but we're not destroyed, always bearing about in our bodies the dying of the Lord Jesus. Why? For we which live are always delivered unto death, that the life of our Lord Jesus would be made manifest in our mortal bodies. For our light affliction, the body of Christ going through tribulation and persecution, our light affliction, which is only but for a moment, worketh for us a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. That is bringing us to the feast of glory, the feast of tabernacles, the feast of ingathering, the feast of all feasts of the Lord, which we are, as a body of Christ, going to eat and experience in the last days. That is what we're seeing here in Revelation 12, the woman, the church. The church of the living God is in travail. Why? Through this tribulation. How much tribulation will there be? Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21 says that there'll be a time of trouble such as there never was, since there was a nation, neither shall ever be again. So great a tribulation. But pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. What's a Sabbath day? When things are wrapping up. The consummation of all things. For then shall be a time of great tribulation. So much tribulation that if it were possible, showing signs and wonders, that the very elect would be deceived if it were possible. He said, these are the beginning of sorrows. These are the birth pains. These are the times of travail upon the church, that she will bring forth a man-child caught up to God and to his throne. During that time, I give power unto my two witnesses. Why? Because everything is established in the mouth of two or three witnesses. These are the two olive trees. These are the two golden candlesticks. The two olive trees are the cherubim of glory, which overshadow the mercy seat. Paul said in Hebrews 9:5, we cannot now speak particularly about that. Why? Because he was in the Pentecostal reign, in the Pentecostal season, in the season of Pentecost. But now we're coming into the Feast of Tabernacles, where now the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat, of which can be spoken particularly in the work of the ministry, for the cherubim of glory is the highest level of glory in the church. The cherubim are not angels. They are the church in the image of Jesus Christ. You see, God placed, after the fall of Adam, at the east end of the garden of God, cherubim, and that's a capital C. Why? Because that is Jesus Christ. A capital C, that's a cherubim with a flaming sword. turning every which way to keep the way of the tree of life. Not to keep man out, but to keep the way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. That's a capital C. Why? Because he has a lion, man, ox, and eagle face in the glory, for God has shown forth his glory in the face of Jesus Christ. And they four had their four faces. That is a lion. That shows Jesus in Matthew as a lion of the tribe of Judah. We see him as the perfect man in Mark. A lion, man, in Mark proclaims Jesus and that glory of a perfect man. Then we see him in Luke as the ox, the suffering servant, and the genealogy in the collateral line of Mary. Then we see him as the flying eagle, the face of an eagle, in John. The four faces of our Lord is the capital C, the cherubim, lion, man, ox, and eagle. Now, the church in the last days is a small c, the Zoe, the living creatures, the beast, that we see in Revelation 4, which are the redeemed of the Lord. The 24 elders and the four beasts sing the song of the redeemed, for they are the redeemed of the Lord. They are not angels, for God never redeemed angels, only the seed of Abraham. This is the church in its glory in the last days. In not their own lion, man, ox, and eagle face, but in the face of Jesus Christ through him and his work of Calvary, that we will have the same four cherubim, the four winged creatures of Ezekiel 1 and Ezekiel 10. These are the cherubim of glory, as a wheel in the middle of a wheel. The spirit of the living creatures is in the wheels, and we find they have the appearance of a man, Ezekiel 1:4. The appearance of a man is coming out of the fire, who make his angel spirits, his ministers, a flame of fire. This Holy Ghost fire, they come out of the midst of the amber of fire as the appearance of a man. And they four had their four faces. These are the four living creatures. These are the cherubim of glory. And they four had their four faces, the faces of a lion, the face of a man, an ox, and an eagle. The same that we see of the living creatures in Revelation 4 and Revelation 5, the beast, the 24 elders, seated upon the 24 seats in heaven, where we're seated in Christ Jesus, seat set at the right hand of God. We will be caught up to those seats at the throne, the man child caught up to God and to his throne in Revelation 12. Those are the beasts, or the living creatures, the Zoe, which have the face of a lion, man, ox, and eagle. That face is the glory of God in Jesus Christ. You see, Paul said, God has shown forth his glory in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency might be of God, the excellency of the power might be of God and not of ourselves. Those are the cherubim of glory, which is the glory of Jesus Christ, in the highest glory it will be in the last days, that we see in Revelation 4 and Revelation 5 that have six wings. The ones in Ezekiel had four wings. What are the wings? The wings are what we have, the ability to fly upon the wind of doctrine, without the wings carrying us into a higher glory. Four wings certainly is a higher glory, flying upon the wind of doctrine. But six wings is Elohim status, as gods, that is judges, little G-O-D-S, in the highest glory the church will receive before the second advent of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he comes a second time and sets his feet upon the Mount of Olives. You see, there will be many gods, a little G-O-D-S, which are judges. And we find in Obadiah there will be many saviors, little s. Those are little c, cherubim of glory. The Lord Jesus is that spirit. We are not the spirit of God. Spirit of God's in us. Christ is in us, but we're not Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory, is the kingdom of God. That Christ in you, the hope of glory, which is the kingdom, in a spiritual kingdom, where we have in the dispensation of grace. Grace now reigns. Grace reigns through righteousness. During this time that there will be great tribulation, and through this great tribulation, through this sorrows, will be birth pangs upon us, the church, that God can bring forth the man child. That man is Christ Jesus in us. What will bring it about? Travail upon the woman, being with child, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. Revelation 12:1. Well, what will happen? Will we bring forth Jesus? Will the Lord bring to the birth? And shall he not bring forth? The Lord himself will bring it forth. But as immediately as the woman is in trial and she's about to bring forth, there's another wonder in heaven, a great red dragon having 7 heads, 10 horns, and 10 crowns upon his head. There went to devour the woman and her seed as soon as she brought forth. The devil will do everything he can, the old serpent, the dragon, the scorpion, to devour her child, the man child, Jesus in you. Somebody said, well, certainly that's Jesus 2,000 years ago in the manger. No, it's not. Because you see in Revelation 12, 2 wings of a great eagle is given to the woman of a great eagle. Why? Not a lion, man, ox, but now an eagle. She's coming to that fullness of glory. Well, where does she fly into heaven? No, she flieth into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God. When is that? That's pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. What flight? 2 wings of a great eagle given to the woman, where she flieth into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared of God. You didn't prepare it yourself. You didn't buy a bunch of freeze-dried fruit, bury it out there, and store up a bunch of silver and gold for yourself. A place prepared of God. Two wings of a great eagle given to the woman, the church, where she flieth into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God. God prepares a place. Where she's nourished from the face of the serpent for a time, times, and dividing of a time, 3.5 years, 42 months, 1,260 days, and that is the time that the woman has 2 wings of a great eagle. She's coming, going to come out of the wilderness into this tabernacle with God forever and ever, eternal world without end throughout eternity, which kingdom there will be no end, and dominion forever and ever and ever, Daniel 7:3-13. Well, that kingdom of God, that kingdom there where we have the spiritual kingdom, Christ in us, the hope of glory, will usher in the kingdom age where the Lord Jesus will literally set up his kingdom in the world, in the earth, for 1,000 years. What will bring forth Jesus in you? The woman will birth a man-child caught up to God and to his throne. What throne? Jesus said, if you overcome, I'll grant you to sit with me in my throne. Sit, S-I-T, that's for us. Even as I overcame, Jesus said, and am set, S-E-T. I'm going on higher. I'm the man that is God, that I am set down, S-E-T, down with my Father in his throne. Jesus is God. We're not. We're adopted sons and daughters of God, yes, but we're not God. Sons and daughters of God, yes. But the Son of God is the Father of glory. That's the reason in Revelation 3:21, Jesus said, even as I overcame, and I'm not just set at the right hand of God, S-I-T, I am set, S-E-T, a state settled in heaven, down with my Father in his throne, S-E-T, Revelation 3:21, he is the God of glory, the blessed and only omnipotent God, 1 Timothy 6:15 and 16, the blessed and only potentate, King of kings, Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, nor see, nor can see. That man is God Almighty. Jesus Christ is that man. We will be seated, S-E-A-T-E-D, the cherubim of glory, literally set, S-I-T, set, S-I-T, down in that throne, set down in Christ, and grant to sit with me in my throne. and that is Jesus Christ. It's a place for us. That is through great tribulation. We will birth a man-child through these sorrows. So if you're going through something, a great time of trouble, tribulation, well, we are suffering tribulation now. Tribulation worketh patience, but this is only in the land of peace. What will we do in the swelling of Jordan? If we haven't been able to run with the footmen and they've worried us, how will we contend with the horsemen? Yes, we are going to go through a time of great tribulation. And immediately after the tribulation of those days, not before, not in the middle of, but immediately after the tribulation of those days, shall the sign of the Son of Man appear in heaven, and he'll send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet and gather together his elect. We're the elect of God. We're the chosen of God. Make your calling and election sure. And he will gather us where? Immediately after the tribulation of those days, which is the great tribulation. Well, we're going through the great tribulation, yes. Now, somebody said, well, I didn't think we're appointed to the wrath of God. You're not. But he does not come down until after the seals, trumpets, and vials, wherein is filled up the wrath of God, the Lord keeping us, two wings of a great eagle, where we flap into the wilderness, where we have a place prepared of God, nourished from the faith of the serpent, for a time, times, dividing of a time, and immediately after the tribulation of those days, shall the sign of the Son of Man appear in heaven with power and great glory, send his angels, gather together his elect. When? After the tribulation. What are we doing? We're going through the great tribulation. This is a time of winter. It's a time of snow, hail, and fire. God, literally, all these performing the will of God, according to Psalm 148. Are these not in my treasures? The snow, the hail, all of this is in the treasures of God. The snow is in the time of winter. What? That's a great tribulation. For it's during this time of sorrows, the birth pangs, that God brings forth a great, great glory in and through the bride of Christ and the church, the false church, Mystery Babylon. Revelation 18:7 says that Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, the false church, says, I said a queen, I am no widow, I will see no sorrow. I will have no sorrows. I will have no birth pangs. I've already got all I'm going to get, and that's it. But God said in 1 hour, all those great riches will come to naught, for God, the Lord God, judgeth her. Till the next time, this is Brother Dennis Beard saying, behold, the real Jesus.